Air conditioning at the Nino Aquino International Airport Terminal 3 shut off, causing discomfort to thousands of passengers. The terminal's cooling system has been turned off since last night to allow the installation of 6 new cooling towers. It's expected to be back up today. Within this hour, in fact, airport authorities say around 27,000 passengers and over 100 local and international flights have been affected by the disruption. Check-in counters, immigration, departure and security checks, among others, were also affected by the shutdown. The Philippine Tourism Promotions Board and the Tourism Department announcing the country's participation in the World Expo 2025 in Osaka, Japan. The event, which will be held from April to October next year, aims to foster hope and reconnect humanity while exploring innovative approaches to building a sustainable future. There, according to the TPB, the Philippines will feature the Philippine Pavilion, showcasing the country's diversity and culture.
Our pavilion celebrates our nation's rich diversity and interconnectedness, drawing inspiration from our indigenous weaving traditions. At the Tourism Promotions Board, community-based tourism is a priority agenda for us. Not only to give that unique Philippine experience to our tourists, but also to empower local communities all over the nation. A project that we aim to bolster and sustain. We are likewise proud to say that the pavilion will feature the first ever live performance woven into its facade at a World Expo. Inside will also boast an immersive multi-sensory space that leverages technology to present the rich cultural heritage of our 18 unique regions. We will also showcase programs of the different POC members that contribute to the UNDP Sustainable Development Goals. Come next week, we will be also sharing the intricacies and theme of our pavilion with our Japanese counterparts in Osaka, officially marking our participation in Expo 2025.
Moody's, seeing the possibility of the Federal Reserve cutting rates by 25 basis points in its July 30 to 31 meeting, this timeline is well ahead of the consensus that the central bank will start easing monetary policy in September. The firm attributes this earlier than expected rate cut projection to cooling inflation and labor market data. America's Consumer Price Index declined by 0.1% in June, with core PCE rising softer than expected, marking its smallest gain in more than 3 years. The National Economic and Development Authority Board, chaired by President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., has approved significant changes to the Laguna Lakeshore Road Network project. Now, phase one of the 174 billion peso project now includes the development of connecting roads and interchanges encompassing Tunasan Village in Muntinlupa City, as well as San Pedro Binyan and Cabuyao in Laguna. The project is a 37.5-kilometer primary road and a 12-kilometer viaduct from Lower Bikutan Taguig to Tunasan Muntinlupa. It also includes a 25.5-kilometer shoreline viaduct, an embankment from Tunasan Muntinlupa to Calamba Laguna. Due for completion in 2027, the project is expected to boost economic activity in southern Metro Manila and provinces south of NCR. Meanwhile, the NEDA board also approving the negotiated parameters, terms, and conditions for the Bohol Panglao International Airport project and the Laguindingan International Airport project in Misamis Oriental. The ASEAN Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Officer AMRO joins the growing view that the Philippines will grow slightly slower this year, while think tank Ibon Foundation also doubts the government can even hit its targets for the year. Andrea Taguines gives us a wrap.
The economies of the region.
The ASEAN Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Office follows the lead of the Asian Development Bank in downgrading its 2024 growth forecast for the Philippines. AMRO now expects the Philippine economy to grow slower at 6.1% from its 6.3% outlook back in April. It also slashed its growth forecast for 2025 from an average of 6.5% to 6.3%. AMRO's chief economist said while inflation is becoming less of a problem, the Philippines still needs to address its infrastructure gap to attract more investments and boost growth.
That's one of the weakness in the Philippine economy, the infrastructure gap. And I think the government is very conscious of that and is trying to fill the gap. Unfortunately, I think fiscal space has been used up to some extent during the pandemic. But our assessment is that, you know, there's still a moderate fiscal space in the Philippines, and that they need to crowd in more foreign investment to help to complement the domestic savings. So that's one of the areas where, you know, I think that the Philippines need to work on, together with a liberalization of the regulatory regime.
Despite the downgrade, AMRO's projection is still within the Marcos administration's 6-7% growth target for this year. Progressive economic think tank Ibon Foundation, meanwhile, doubts it would be able to meet that goal, even if economic managers had already lowered their growth assumption from the 6.5-7.5% range. The group's executive director, Sonny Africa, said,
"Spending lumit pa na agriculture, lumit pa na manufacturing, which highlights it's not enough to build infrastructure to develop the economy. Kailangan ng active policies to develop domestic agriculture and domestic industry so that Filipino farmers and Filipino firms can benefit from that infrastructure."
Africa also noted that the infrastructure projects are mostly concentrated in regions that are already developed.
"It should spend more on higher impact infrastructure projects, not the mga capital intensive, import intensive projects, especially outside Metro Manila, because 2/3 of infra spending is in NCR, Central Luzon, and Southern Tagalog."
But the Philippines' economic managers remain confident in their strategy. They are optimistic the Philippines' GDP can hit 6-7% by year end as they bank on stronger household consumption with inflation stabilizing. Officials say the government also continues to help beef up the economy by attracting more investments. They also continue to push for legislative reforms, such as several revenue measures. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
The Asian Development Bank has slightly raised its economic growth forecast for developing Asia and the Pacific this year to 5% from the initial projection of 4.9%. That's as rising regional exports complement resilient domestic demand, while the growth outlook for next year is maintained at 4.9%. In that same report, Asian Development Outlook released today, ADB also forecasting inflation to slow to 2.9% this year amid easing global food prices and the lingering effects of higher interest rates. Now, after a post-pandemic recovery that was driven mainly by domestic demand, the ADB says exports are rebounding and helping propel the region's economic growth. Strong global demand for electronics, particularly semiconductors, used for high technology and AI applications, is boosting exports from several Asian economies. We'll bring you more details from that report later on in the show. Beverages firm Coca-Cola settles its labor dispute with workers' unions in Davao City. Notices of strike were lodged by the unions NMLDCC and Sama Coke, grounded on bargaining deadlock in their respective collective bargaining agreements, or CBAs, with the drinks company. After a series of meetings with the workers, the two parties successfully struck a deal. In the case of NMLDCC, the estimated economic package amounted to over 11 million pesos, benefiting 149 workers. They're also granted a union office and leave, as well as the selection of a third-party arbiter. Sama Coke, meanwhile, is set to receive over 23 million pesos, which will benefit nearly 290 workers. Political provisions such as coverage of the bargaining unit, job security, and union security were also included in the agreement. Now, the Philippine wellness industry grew significantly due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Nurture Wellness Village says while the pandemic was tragic, it also highlighted the importance of wellness, encouraging Filipinos to invest in it. The firm, however, stressed more efforts are needed, such as companies investing in employee wellness. A study valued the Philippines' wellness industry at $41 billion back in 2022, ranking 22nd among over 200 countries.
Before COVID, it was YOLO. You only, you know, okay, bahala na, you only live once, okay, I'm invincible, right? Mm-hmm. So you eat anything you want. And then COVID struck, and everybody's saying,
invincible,
oh,
everybody.
Oh, darn, I'm sick, no? Mm-hmm. And words like immune boosting came to fore. So and then people were saying, when people around them were getting sick, they're saying, okay, what can I do? How can I empower myself? Studies have shown that a healthy employee is 3 times more productive than an unhealthy employee. Again, that has implications in the corporate world, like this is Business Outlook. So the question is, companies, why don't you spend more on prevention because it's very expensive. If you look at your healthcare costs as a company, you'd be shocked at how many companies spend so much for medication, for employee sickness. So the question is for the presidents and CEOs, HR people, okay, why don't you invest in prevention? Why don't you invest in educating your employees so that they don't get sick? Because when employees are sick, you have issues like, of course, absenteeism.
Yeah.
And you have what you call presenteeism, wherein they're there, but they're actually not there.
A group of green energy advocates eyeing to solve the country's high power rates through its so-called solar rooftop challenge. Lady Vicentia tells us more.
A multi-sectoral advocacy is looking to install solar rooftops nationwide with a total of 10 gigawatts capacity. The 10 million solar rooftops challenge was launched to urge government offices, private sector and organizations to join the initiative of installing solar rooftops amid rising electricity costs and climate crisis. This was introduced by around 20 organizations pushing for renewable energy, including the Center for Energy, Ecology and Development, Caritas Philippines, Power for People, and Catholic Bishops Conference of the Philippines. For SEED, the initiative is a step towards reducing fossil fuel emissions that contribute to climate change.
Sa pag-aaral ng SEED, nalaman namin na kaya mahal ang kuryente, ang isa sa mga pinaka dahilan ay ang paggamit natin ng fossil fuels. Nilang marumi.
100% electric.
Na kaya natin mag 100% electrification, no? Kasi napakayaman natin sa renewable energy. At ang kakaiba sa renewable versus sa fossil fuels, pwede tayong magtayo nito kahit hindi konektado sa grid. Isa kasi yun sa challenges natin, eh. Kung mararating na ba ng grid yung mga last mile, yung mga malalayong komunidad. But with solar rooftops, we agree with DOE na isa to sa mga solusyon.
Advocacy groups hope to enter into grants and partnerships to fund the installation of these solar rooftops. Lady Vicentia, ABS-CBN News.
Good news for Bohol residents. They're getting more reliable power. The Philippine Energy Department says Philippine grid operators have successfully energized the Dumanhug-Corelia 230 kilovolts Line 1 and the Dumanhug 70 MVAR project connecting Cebu to Bohol. With a 600 megawatt transfer capacity, the project will boost supply reliability in the Bohol grid by providing direct access to bulk generation from Cebu. This is in addition to the existing Leyte-Bohol submarine cable. The full completion of the project is set for December of this year and is expected to resolve congestion in the Leyte-Bohol 138 kilovolt interconnection, which will alleviate high electricity prices for consumers in the area. From the Philippine Stock Exchange, the ASEAN exchanges have committed to advance ASEAN as an attractive region at the 37th ASEAN Exchanges CEOs meeting hosted by Bursa Malaysia. There you have it. We're seeing PSE President Ramon Monzon right there, smack in the middle. The commitment. The ASEAN Exchanges CEOs presidents have agreed to pursue four proof of concepts over the next 3 years. These are establishing an ASEAN data infrastructure, which will harmonize data structures and standards to form an aggregated ASEAN view. Capacity building for listed issuers. They will create standardized ASEAN ESG curriculum based on relevant global and local requirements to support listed issuers towards efficient, automated, and scalable assurance processes. And transition financing for corporate suppliers. They will incentivize quality reporting across supply chains, working with banks to offer financing programs with preferential rates tied to disclosures and commitment to decarbonize, and the ASEAN ESG awards, rewarding listed issuers with exemplary ESG performance opportunities to elevate business profile internationally. So we're looking forward to how this framework and these programs will come to life and how they'll actually have an impact on companies on the ground.